again to another episode of the Horizon Roundtable. I am Bob McDonald. Normally, Matt Dudek, who you would find on Twitter at Horizon Matt, would be joining us, but he is not today. But you can always find us on the web at horizonroundtable.com. You can find links to all of our social sites and where you can find us, where podcasts are available at horizonroundtable.com/subscribe. Become a patron, patreon.com/horizonroundtable. And Horizon Gonna Horizon. You know what? That's just the title, going to be the title of the podcast. We're just going to get that out of the way right now. And joining me today, it's funny, Scott Meyer, we've had writing for us for Robert Morris for probably around 2 years now. Haven't had an opportunity to get him on, but this week is different. So Scott, welcome, and thanks at long last for joining us.
Howdy, how is everyone?
Well, it's just me, so. I don't know. I'm a Cleveland sports fan. Tell me again.
Well, Mother Nature spared me at least some anger for 24 hours, maybe longer. We'll see.
Yeah, that maybe. I don't know. So, but if you're anybody who's listening to this a little later on this week, Scott's mood might be changed for depending upon the outcome of the other wild card game. But so I know why you wanted to come on, and it seems funny because of the game that happened after the one you witnessed on Wednesday, again, with Robert Morris in Wright State, where Robert Morris basically just kind of phoned it in and lost by like 20-something. They 26, they dropped like 25 or 26. They dropped Wright State dropped 101 on them. Yeah, that was fun. And then, of course, Robert Morris turns around and upsets Purdue Fort Wayne in the most dramatic way possible with Marquise Hastings hitting a three-point shot at the end of the game, end of overtime, to win it. SportsCenter number one play that night. So I can tell you're probably having a mix of emotions right now. But you have the floor, sir.
Well, thank you. Yeah, I'd say mixed emotions is a good way to put it. For folks that don't know, I've got pretty deep ties, and you know this, Bob, I've got pretty deep ties to the school. Obviously I went there. I was a student manager for 3 years for two different head coaches, one of which Tool was the main assistant on, who leads Robert Morris right now. I feel like I look at the program through a different set of lenses than most, just because, I didn't play. I was a student manager, but someone who was actually at the game on Friday night that they honored, it's folks like that that kind of made me keep my deep ties to the program. They made me feel.
He was on it at halftime. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Folks like him, Jeremy Chappelle, AJ Jackson, a lot of those guys are the reason that I still have the deep ties, because they made us feel part of the team, part of the pro. They made us feel like our role was important. And, just to quickly touch on a little bit of where I'm coming from on Robert Morris, one thing I always state to every college freshman is, if I could recommend something to you, it's get involved in athletics one way or another. And that's partly, I think, why I'm still very, very angry. Friday night was great. Yeah, Yep, and it came quick, because we've seen this, Bob. I mean, they've been in the Horizon League for 4 years now. That COVID year really just kind of threw everything.
This is now year four. Yeah, I believe.
Yeah. And I
year four. Yep.
No offense. No offense to the NEC, but that's where we were when I was a student manager there. It's Division I, but honestly, Bob, it's elevated high school ball. It's nothing more than that. You can survive in that league with one dude on your team. And I think Robert Morris got by like that for a while.
It appeared so, because they were doing very, very well at that level.
Yeah, I mean, Tool, I think, so we, my first year as a student manager, we got upset in the quarterfinals, which I honestly, going, thinking back to that year, that was one of those seasons where I think everybody was just glad for it to be over. Mark Schmidt, who is now, I think, still at St. Bonnie, he was, I'll keep my thoughts to him on, to myself. But that was kind of a season where I think it, you know, that was right before Mike Rice came in, and Mike Rice changed.
Before Rutgers.
Yes. Yeah.
I feel like we have to disclaimer that now. Yeah. It's crazy.
He was wild, but I will tell you, there was not a dude that would go to bat for his dudes more than that guy. On the floor, he went at it with us. He kicked me and three managers, Bob, out of practice because somebody didn't
wipe the floor. I totally believe that.
Booted us. He told the Coke dude, because they were delivering, we had vending machines in the old gym, which the UPMC event centers, the Sewell Center, just remodeled. And it was wintertime. Half our team was sick. The Coke guy came in to fill the machine, and he left the garage door open, and Rice went up to the dude and told him if he didn't shut the damn door, he was switching to Pepsi. That's the kind of dude he was. That's the dude he was. But he changed Robert Morris basketball. He changed the whole culture. And Tool was there for all of it. And right now, like I said, Friday night was great, but Bob, we've seen this. How many times did they pull some of these out of their rear end only to turn around and give up 150 to Wright State? And it's like you're watching, you know, NBA Street out there where somebody's putting up 60-some percent shooting and you got five guys on the floor that are guys.
I'm with it. I'm doing the NBA Jam stuff, you know.
Yeah.
I'm way older than that.
Yeah. I mean,
you're not wrong.
That's where my frustration, and you know, I've had my dad is an alum, my two uncles are an alum, and my aunt is an alum. We've got deep Bobby Moe ties. And I've got a sparkly ring upstairs that says 2009 NEC champion. I know where this program was. I know who changed this culture. And Tool was there for some of it. And I just, watching so many of these games, it's there because, well, Friday night, it's there. They led at halftime. They kept they kept Purdue Fort Wayne at arm's length, and they stunned them at the end. And I've had some, I'm in a group chat on Twitter, X, or Bird, or whatever it is now. with some guys that were there when I was there and some younger guys, and they've asked me about, do I think the holiday travels affected some of this? And you know, one thing I've been asked is about Tool, and do I think it's time for Tool to go? For those of you that don't know, he's been there as on the staff for 17 years.
Yeah.
He doesn't look like he's even 20. Even now he does, because he's got some gray hair, because he's got a few kids and a wife and everything now. So he's, you know, obviously.
Yeah, the gray hair threw me off because I didn't realize I was older than Andy Tool. I just now have gray hair coming in.
Yeah. Yeah. He, you know, knowing him personally, heck, his wife is the recruiter for my uncle's department at Dick's Sporting Goods. So, you know, I've got both sides. I know the personal side of Tool, and I know the basketball side of Tool. And something I've been asked a lot is, what's wrong? Is it time for a change? I don't know. I don't think so, because obviously it's something is there. I think part of the problem is with RMU Athletics itself. That school, I don't know if you've been to Moon or have been to the school at all, but it's a fairly heavy commuter school, at least when I was there, and I'm pretty sure it still is. I just don't see the love and the tie-in from the community, the tie-in from the student body is not there. And it was when I was there, because Bob, we would, the lacrosse team, the hockey team, the girls lacrosse team, youth basketball players from Moon would come to the Sewell Center, and there we would pack that place on Thursdays and Saturday nights. I mean, it was fun. Now you could count how many dudes are there on you wouldn't even need past your middle finger on your right hand. It's just, I think that's where a lot of the problems start. The athletic department knew they had to go up in level, but I don't know if they were ready. Because that's where it starts. Are there problems with the staff and recruiting? Yes. It's just college sports now. If they get somebody worth a darn, they're going to leave and go to a bigger school. It's happened to Tool, you know, a dozen times or so. Mm-hmm. And
yep. It's ironic you mentioned this, considering Cleveland State is now having this exact same situation happen. Scott Garrett, we actually did not mention this last week. I can't believe we didn't. Scott Garrett is leaving as athletic director at Cleveland State, and he's going to Wake Forest. You kind of knew that was going to happen, but, you know, nothing prepares for it, obviously. Yeah. But I understand your conflict. I understand your conflict. You know, you have a personal connection with Andy Tool, and that makes this kind of whole thought process as to, is it time for, are we really at a point where Robert Morris needs to think about making a change? Yeah, it's a difficult decision. Mm-hmm. A decision, incidentally, that is not unique to the Horizon League. We run into the right. Look at IUPUI, or I don't know. You're a Robert Morris guy. I don't know if you want to look at IUPUI at the moment. Yeah. Although last week you did with that 40-point drubbing. You guys took 2 years of frustration on those guys.
Yeah.
But to your point, you know, Matt Crenshaw, we've had him on the podcast. Great guy, but it's just not happening. And to your point, it's funny because we have so many examples of that. We don't have any kind of conflict with Detroit Mercy. Mike Davis just is kind of done. Oh, by the way, you guys played them. By the way, keep you guys.
Yeah.
By the way, Robert Morris plays Detroit Mercy. I feel the trepidation. I'm sure you're feeling a little bit of trepidation considering how things have gone over the last 3 years.
Yep.
Although I have to say even though, especially the way Northern Kentucky played Detroit Mercy played Northern Kentucky. Well, I'll talk about that a little later because it pisses me off that that's exactly what's going on there. They got all their they got a bunch of people back, and then all of a sudden they're hanging with Northern Kentucky. I'm like, oh great, no kidding, knew that was going to happen. Can't imagine why. But no, I get it, and I think we may be. It just seems to me, given the way things have gone, and conversely, and we're going to talk about this. I'm going to talk about this a little later. The way that Sonny Wicks has turned around Green Bay as quickly as he has, they were in a tie for first place. In the Horizon League, a team that the official Horizon League poll picked to finish last, which we didn't do any better. I think we picked them in 59, is now in a first place tie with Oakland. And you see, and you've seen it before. You saw with Cleveland State and Dennis Gates, what he did that year of that turnaround. You look at that juxtaposed to, I gotta admit, three teams, Robert Morris, Detroit Mercy, and IUPUI. All three of those schools are, I really think, they really look like schools that are going to be looking for a head coach next year. They really do. Now, will that actually happen? Who's to say? But it is definitely trending in that direction. And there obviously are some, there are some, you know, extenuating circumstances. There may be, you know, a little bit more grace in some ways, or maybe they just don't want to buy the, they don't want to pay the buyout, looking at you, Detroit Mercy. But yeah, I we're at a point where we have three Horizon League teams that I absolutely think will be at a minimum we'll be looking for head coaches next year, and then I think there may be one or two other head coaches in this league who may be finding places else to go because they've done so well. But that's I understand.
That's kind of where we thought Poole was. I mean, remember he was, they went, gosh, I think his first 5 years as head coach, they went to the title game. Like four of them. They beat, obviously, you know, I'll say this extra loud because she's upstairs, but they whooped, not whooped, but they took care of the local flavor here where I live, the Wildcats of Kentucky. And after that, he was probably...
I know what you're saying. You had to say that a little louder.
I had to. You know, I had to because we weren't even married at the time. We were just engaged, and we watched it together with my Robert Morris alum father. But, you know, thinking back then, Tool was probably one of the hotter names at that level. And everybody thought he would go to Penn where he played, or somewhere back close to where he's from in the Jersey Northeast area. And it's just, it, there's, I don't think.
And I can, I mean, and I do see, I, to your point, I do see him. I don't see this being the end of the road for him by any stretch of the imagination. Do I see him at maybe an assistant's job? Yes. Do I see him at another NEC job? Yeah. But we're also counting our chickens before we hatch. We have no idea if Robert Morris is going to pull the trigger on this at all.
If things keep going the way
they do, it's probably going to be more likely than not that that's the case. Same being, obviously the same being with both IUPUI and, you know, Detroit Mercy as well, because those two teams are somehow even in a worse situation. Keep in mind that at least in Robert Morris's case, they can, you see the potential there. You do. We've seen
that's
it over the years.
Seen,
I mean, for as weird as as embarrassing, let's call it what it is, as embarrassing as the losses they had against IUPUI, an IUPUI team that had six players, by the way. Five players at that moment. Was it six or five? I don't remember. Yeah, for six players. It's six guys. Mm-hmm. And they beat Robert Morris by 10. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
As bad as that is, and as bad as the IUPUI situation was last year, and they still beat Robert Morris. Robert Morris then turns around and beats Youngstown State. That game that Robert Morris beat Youngstown State, that didn't stop Youngstown State from getting the outright regular season title, but it sure slowed him down a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
And you're talking about a Youngstown State team that has a Youngstown State team last year that was arguably certainly was the best Youngstown State team that they have had in their history of Division One, and almost one of the best they've had ever in their history. And Robert Morris turns around, Robert Morris beats that team. So I see where the potential is. It's just, we don't see it anywhere near enough. We just don't.
Consistency is just not there.
And that's the problem, and I think that's going to be, and I think at the end of the day, that is going to be, that's going to be the end game right there. That's it.
Yeah. I think. I think that's
only,
what'll.
My only hope is that whoever, any team who fires their coach, please, could you all, any of you, please consider hiring your replacements before April 7th? After April 7th, I'm not going to care. Before April 7th, I'm on board. After April 7th, it's just going to be another day for me where I'm going to look up and say, oh, somebody is in. Yeah, like basically any other time. Yeah, so.
Yeah.
That's where we're at.
I'm curious to see. You know, I know Chris King a little bit, the AD. Obviously, they've had a rocky road with the president. I won't even get into any of that because the.
What a dumbass that guy was.
Oh, what
unbelievable. Let me tell you. I mean, I don't know anything about. I don't know a lot about Robert Morris as a school, but to basically go over the AD's head and say, "Oh, we're gonna get rid of all of hockey."
Mm-hmm. Like,
what kind of a dumbass are you? And that's probably why he's not there anymore, because they finally realized, oh shit, I should probably change presidents at this point.
Yeah, because if so, the hockey programs, let's just be honest for a minute. Robert Morris is never going to win a national title in any sport, more than likely, outside of maybe they got a puncher's chance in hockey, just the way hockey is. The women's team was ranked, and they won their conference. The men went to the NCAA tournament a couple times as well. So those two sports don't make a lick of sense cutting. The team that does is the damn football team. Because, Bob, you and I, we can play 2 out of 11.
That is not a good football team. That is not a good football team.
They suck. They suck. And that, I don't know if you can cuss on these things, but that jackass of a president had his, I don't know. I know a little bit about the situation, but I don't know enough. But to cut those two programs, that's why everybody was so upset. Because it made no sense, because that was your two best programs in athletics.
Oh man!
Yeah, it's just and if he was there,
I've seen some doozies in my day. That one, the follow through, just on the sheer follow through that they actually had to go. The school went through with it and then had to start these programs all over again because they finally did a do over. Cleveland State did that same exact thing when they added lacrosse and what we're going to lop off wrestling at that point. That was stupid too. Fortunately, cooler head. Yeah, and they would have gotten away with it if it weren't for those pesky kids and that dumb dog too.
Yeah.
But to be fair, the AD was John for Cleveland State. The AD was John Perry, and basically like. Lacrosse was like his baby and he didn't give a shit about anything else besides making sure that John Perry cared about two things: making sure the books were balanced in athletics and adding lacrosse. That was it. That was his whole thing. And of course the president of Cleveland State at the time was some dumb shit who couldn't even remember Isaiah Thomas's name. I wish that was true. I wish that was false. It is true. Look it up. He called the guy Isaiah Thompson when he was at Florida International. I wish I was making that up. And then of course there was a whole flap about him and his, anyway, but that was all it. But anyway, we were talking about Robert Morris. I'm sorry.
Yeah, you're good. No,
similar situation, except
Robert
actually did pull the trigger. It didn't reverse itself at the last minute, which Cleveland State, thank God, did.
Yeah.
And they had to start all over again. And thankfully, in Robert Morris's case, just with the type of backing the community had for those hockey teams, thank God that was there. Otherwise, we would be singing a different tune, wouldn't we?
100%. A lot of it. Their biggest tie-in is the Penguins, and they've got – I mean, they were tight with them when I was there. I was a sport management major. I did some, you know, not long-term internships, but day-to-day internships with some of the events the Penguins did. So I knew, like, the community support was there. You know, the Penguins – and everybody – reached out to me and says, oh, why couldn't Mario Lemieux jump? That's not his thing. I mean, it's not Mario's job to jump in and save him. However, all that the president had to do was probably go to the Penguins and say, hey, we're struggling financially with keeping these programs. The cost is high. I'm sure. Oh, I mean, I don't know how much you've seen of it, but the Penguins did all they could to help them come back. They have RMU night. They did it all. And I just honestly, getting back to the basketball program, I really, Tool gets some blame. I'm not going to not blame it. But it's a tough, for that level, it's a tough place to get your better players to go. Well, I mean, he had, back in the NEC days, he had Marquise Reed, who was he was a freshman player of the year and damn near won the NEC player of the year and went off in the tournament and then left just to play at Clemson. My dad's even asked me, is it time for Tool or what's missing? I said, it's still there. It's not like Andy Tool forgot how to coach over a he didn't. That's not it at all. It's just, and he's had a couple good games, so I kind of feel bad blasting him, but why do we keep trotting a player like Jackson Last out there in money situations? Now, saying that, he's the one that threw the full court pass. He got a rebound late to help him, you know, get to overtime and win the game. So I can't, you know, base it off the last few games. But you've seen Jackson Last. I mean, the last couple years, the dude's in there in money time. And I'm like, it's just the overall feeling of the athletic department that I'm getting from people that still live there is just something. Something's missing, and I think that hurts recruiting, and it surely is hurting the community support, because you've got Moon and Montour High School that are within a pitching wedge of Robert Morris's campus. Why aren't those students at these basketball games on Saturday nights? Why can't we get, my uncle is a fairly high-up executive with Dick's Sporting Goods. He's a Robert Morris alum. I've talked to him. He said, we do stuff with him, but, you know, he's like, to his knowledge, they've never really been outright asked for anything. I said, Dick's would be, it's a national sporting brand that's local. You've got, not that they would need to, but you could get a little bit of NIL stuff there. Athletic department from the top is hurting every program, and it's hurting the community support, because that place ain't hard to play, Bob.
I am glad you brought up the community support, because you look at Robert. I looked at the crowd at Robert Morris. Let's be honest. It was sad. You look at the crowds at IUPUI. They are equally sad. And I keep forgetting that all the IUPUI men's games are at Farmers Coliseum. I guess that's part of the deal, part of the arrangement. Having been to Farmers Coliseum for the conference tournament twice already, it is a giant pain to get into that arena, just to drive into the arena to get to it. And, but juxtapose that between the environment that we saw with Oakland and at Youngstown State on Friday night for the ASPN2 game against Wright State. You look at those two things and you see, first of all, you see Greg Campy, who has been very, very vocal and probably the most vocal person I have seen in the Horizon League related to attendance and crowds and getting butts in the seats, been extremely vocal about that. Extremely vocal about that. And where Oakland is right now, they are now in the tie for first place in the Horizon League. they have that whole thing going for them. Now they've got a Greg Campy coming in saying, okay, we're doing our part. You guys need to do your part. And looking at that Wednesday game, they absolutely did their part that day. Same mm-hmm. thing with Youngstown State. I can tell you right now, if you'd have told me 10 years ago, if you'd have told me 10 years ago that Youngstown State would, well, first of all, be winning. And also, yeah, they were not good. Before Jared Calhoun, they were not good. They were just, I mean, they had some like flashes, they had some glimpses, but they were never a very good team. But to not only winning, but also to pack Beakley Center as they have been doing is really kind of a testament to what Jared Calhoun has done, not only building up the ball club, but also building up that community so that when a game like Wright State on ESPN2 comes aboard, him and the folks over at Youngstown State can band together and say, you know what? Let's do a full court press here, do a red out. Let's get this going. Let's get this good. Let's get this crowd into it. And they absolutely did that. And when I look at the teams that are the teams that don't that have an attendance issue and juxtapose with, I don't know what's going on with Cleveland State. I'll be honest with you. Cleveland State hasn't lost a game at home in a year and a half, and they still can't get anybody to go, but that's a whole other thing. And I don't want to put me in the crosshairs on that one because I'm ever reclusive and I don't want to go anywhere, but no, juxtapose that, but so you see a couple of things. One, you see that within the Horizon League, you can turn around a program in relatively short order, and you can use that turnaround to drum up further and further interest. And we've seen that with Youngstown State. We've always seen that with Oakland. You're starting to see that again with Green Bay. Milwaukee, you're starting to see that them come around as well with Bart Lundy. Snow game notwithstanding on Friday. But you see all of those things happen. And you see that you can do that. And I think at mm-hmm. some point in time, I see at least three schools looking at that and saying, you know what? I think it's time to make a change.
Yeah.
Are we going to see that? I don't know, but maybe. It seems more and more likely. Robert Morris seems to be a very likely candidate for a coaching change. IUPUI, we talk about Farmers Coliseum being in the, being far, far away from campus. At some point in time, I guess there is a plan once they switch over to IUI to build something, something on campus, at some sort of venue. I think they dedicated like $50 million to it or something like that. So mm-hmm. there may be something in the works at IUI when it becomes IUI. Is Matt Crenshaw around when that happens? I don't know. And then there's Detroit Mercy. Detroit Mercy, who, man, let me tell you something. Detroit Mercy, you've seen Detroit Mercy, man.
Mm-hmm.
You probably wish you hadn't seen Detroit Mercy.
Mm-hmm.
Detroit Mercy it looks like Detroit Mercy, I said this a few episodes back, that Detroit Mercy is going to do the thing they always do every year, where they basically have all these injury and eligibility issues and all this dumb crap that I know Detroit Mercy treats the non-conference like a cash register. They just ring the bell and take the cash. That's what it's more prominent. It was more visible this year, more prominent this year because they were so bad in just about every game that wasn't, for some reason, Mississippi. But now we're at the point from the non-conference games where they were, aside from maybe one maybe two games, I think the Central Michigan game was also a stinker. You had a by and large non-competitive non-conference schedule for Detroit Mercy. And then you had the first six games that were pretty much laughers the entire time. I mean, IUPUI ran him out of the gym. IUPUI. Mm-hmm. They did that. And so imagine my surprise that, I mean, imagine my non-surprise, actually. I'm not surprised about this. That Detroit Mercy lost again. They're 0-18 now. No, there's pretty much the only way that Detroit Mercy would be able to finish 500 is if they, you know, ran the table, won the conference tournament, and made it to the Sweet 16. That's not happening. But they gave Northern Kentucky a run for their money. They only lost by 5 because they brought back, because Jaden Stone's back, and he did outstanding, as he does every time he's on the floor. You had surprising games from Mac Mansell, who has been hot and cold, mostly cold, and Marcus Tankersley, who has been the only other guy being able to score on a fairly regular basis. And Northern Kentucky didn't know what to do with them, which I couldn't believe. But it's funny because I see what happened. They brought back, so Jaden Stone was back. Odin, don't call me Weird Al Yankovic, is back. Just call him, he spells his last name completely different, but yeah, I'm just going to start saying that for a while. Emmanuel Quach, finally, it looks like he is finally at a point where he can get a little few more extended minutes. They don't have Ryan Hurst anymore, though. It looks like he's going to be out for the season, so not all the way there. But you see, they brought back all these, they have all these guys, especially in the front court. They finally have a rotation in the front court, which is good because Eduardo Acadia still can't stop fouling. And you see the difference. Now, and they have Robert Morris next, but good news is Robert Morris at home. And I'd love to know who Robert Morris is going to be guarding, Jaden Stone. Jackson Lath, come on down.
Oh, God.
And you're going to break out in a cold sweat with me saying that. But I will say this. Detroit Mercy is not going to have an answer for Marquise Hastings. They're not going to have an answer for Marquise Hastings. I doubt they're going to have an answer for even Stephon Walker.
And maybe Corbin.
And if Josh Corbin has the game we expect him to have, yeah. I don't know why, but I really like Alvaro Folgueras.
Yeah.
I really like that guy. I love that guy. Yeah.
He brings good energy.
I keep forgetting that part.
The thing I've noticed with him is his energy is just infectious because some of the guys in our group chat noticed it. Whenever he first came on, you know, started being inserted into the lineup, it's like when he's on the floor, they play at a different speed. And it's a different speed, a different intensity. Because when you got dudes like Marquise Hastings and Josh Corbin, man, there ain't no damn reason you should be giving up a C note to people and losing by 25 plus. It's just that's the most frustrating thing with them is they've got, you know, three or four guys that you can win with, but the problem is they got too many. They just can't.
Yeah, you know what's gonna be great? Problem. I love this. This is gonna be my favorite thing of the favorite thing. When they play is gonna be, and I know it's coming too. It's gonna be Folgueras on Eduardo De Acadia. Those two are gonna. I guarantee you, De Acadia is gonna foul him like 3 times, and then he'll foul Marquise Hastings the other 2 to foul out. No, but, I mean, curious. But yeah, I do like his game. I absolutely love that guy's game. Absolutely love it. Yep. And I do not think between Walker and Hastings and Folgueras, I don't know. I mean, Watch could be okay as far as the rebounding is concerned. He's not a scorer. It's pretty clear. Mm-hmm. Delcadia, he just fouls entirely too much. And don't get me started on Yankovic, because I don't think because he just came back. I'm surprised he would play as much as he did, to be honest with you. So I know you're a little nervous because this for Robert Morris is most definitely falls in the category of trap game.
Mm-hmm. But they could run off some games here.
But it is at home. And I was going to originally say this was probably going to be Detroit Mercy's best chance of winning. After seeing Friday's game, I'm not so sure anymore. I'm not sure.
That's kind of why I wrote this morning, you know, Robert Morris has a chance over the next two games to get some steam going into that Cleveland State matchup. And
they absolutely do.
You know, they blew the
bill. This could be the turnaround.
I thought that after they won by
seriously, look at this. They're playing Detroit Mercy, and then they're playing IUPUI. Okay, also a trap game. Never mind. That's also a trap game. Sorry.
But they could go into that.
Yeah. And I think also, too, and Scott, I might have lost you there for a minute, but Cleveland State has got Detroit Mercy, not as good as they were, not as bad as they were, but still not very good. IUPUI, I have no idea what's going on with them. And then the Cleveland State game, and Cleveland State, I don't know what happened to Cleveland State this weekend. There was way too, put it to you this way, there was way too much Cleveland Browns in Cleveland State this week.
Yeah.
I will say that, but at least Cleveland State was winning in some of those instances. They just could not get anything together. They blew a 19-point lead against Milwaukee. You don't do that against Milwaukee, especially this Milwaukee team that looks like it's that pretty much full strength now. Don't do that. And you definitely don't do that. And you're up by four against Green Bay with right near the end of the game. And then Green Bay turns around and rattles off 12 straight points. No, you can't do that. You don't do that when you got a guy like Noah Reynolds who can go off. A guy like Foster Wonders can go off. And by the way, again, Green Bay is having an absolutely phenomenal season. The fact that we're talking to them, and we're talking with them 7-8 games into the conference schedule, and they are tied for first place in the Horizon League. I know Matt and I have had conversations about who should be coach of the year. We originally said it was going to be John Kaufman. I think it's going to be Sundance. Got to be. I mean, really?
Yeah.
What he has done. It's good. It's great you were able to get Noah Reynolds in there, but also just the support, that whole entire team. You have so many weapons now. Foster Wonders was outstanding from today. Outstanding. He hit 5 3-pointers. I mean, they did it with David Douglas Jr., their freshman, was out today too. So they did this without him either. So. Yeah. Man, as pissed off as I was about Cleveland State blowing a second lead in a row, I gotta say, man, they did an Green Bay did an outstanding job, and I think we only play Green Bay. It doesn't get any easier for Green Bay either. They got to go to Wright State in Northern Kentucky. So that's going to be fun.
We've got them coming up the first week of February, but it's at home.
Yeah.
And they lost by, earlier on New Year's Eve, they lost by 17. We've got them coming up at home. But, I mean, just looking, I mean, there's Wright they State got a real chance.
Wright State, I thought for sure Wright State was going to go back to doing Wright State things again, especially after, sorry to say, the Robert Morris game. They were up by 10. They were up by 10 on Youngstown State, and Youngstown State just steamrolled them at the end of that game. Just steamrolled them. And Gabe Dines out here pissing people off 6 blocks. If he was on anybody else's team, Youngstown State fans have got to love this guy. He is a freshman. He's 7'3". They were talking about it in the Jordan Burnfield and David Padgett on the broadcast were talking about how this guy was like, I didn't realize it because in the preseason I had talked to Jared Calhoun. During when we were getting stuff ready for preview week. And he had mentioned that Gabe Dines had put on like 20 to 30 pounds. And I'm like, I see him and I'm like, how skinny was he before? I got an answer on Friday. He was 190 pounds, apparently. 190 pounds. That guy, 7'3", 190 pounds. You remember the movie Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory, and Mike TV was shrunk down and they decided they were going to put him in the taffy puller to stretch him out so he could be tall again, so he could be like a normal size again? I think that's what Gabe Dines was in high school. What happened with Mike TV after they put him in the taffy puller? And apparently, but he put on weight and I think he's averaging like 4 blocks a game. That's insane. So I'm glad. I don't know when. Yes, I think that's going to be a big one for them. That was a big win for Youngstown State on Friday. They needed that win. They absolutely needed that win. Youngstown State had a huge week between the win against the comfort behind win against Wright State, and then that win on against Purdue Fort Wayne. And Purdue Fort Wayne's got, they got problems. You saw them. But fortunately, Purdue Fort Wayne plays IUPUI at home on Wednesday. So, but Youngstown State has got to go up to the arena play Oakland. Ooh, that's going to be a good one. So, you know as well as I do, Campy's going to be like, everybody's got to show up that game. And they will. They will. So, all right. Scott, do you have anything else? I think I'm pretty much done here. I think he might have ran away again. All right. Well, like Scott alluded to, he is going to be, you have your article coming out on Monday morning. So chances are, if you're watching, listening to this during the week, it's already out. So you can go ahead and read Scott's article. At SMeyer87 on Twitter. I'm never calling it X, ever, ever, ever. But that's going to wrap it up for us. Next week, theoretically, we don't have any Sunday games next week. Thank God. This Sunday thing was messing me up. So next week, Matt presumably will be back. Until then, horizonroundtable.com. That is when that's where you can find all our past podcast episodes and our articles. You can pull us up wherever podcasts are available, and you can pull us up wherever on your Amazon or Google devices. So tune in next week. Until then, thank you all for listening.